I know, I said I wouldn't go anywhere near this man's movies, even if it killed me in a prior video. But when have I been known for my consistency? To fully understand the Frankenstein's monster that is the Far Cry movie, it is important to understand A, the man himself, Uwe Boll. Uwe Boll? What? And the original Far Cry games that the movie is based on. Uwe Boll is a German film producer and director, widely known for his questionable video game movies. He apparently studied at the University of Cologne and holds a PhD? Holy shit. So from this point on, I will affectionately refer to him as Dr. Boll, because no other title of his can truly communicate his unbridled genius in its full efficacy, and because it's easier to pronounce than his actual fucking name. As mentioned in my House of the Dead review, he made a movie on it.
Muerte. That's Spanish for death. Because you don't speak Mexican.
It was hilariously bad. He also created and directed Blood Rain, Alone in the Dark, Auschwitz, Jesus Christ. The only good movies I've actually seen come from him are The Postal Movie, which seems like the unanimous conclusion across the internet.
I get a little horny here on stage sometimes. If you see the crowd and all the children.
Are you fucking kidding me?
But I also quite liked Rampage, for reasons. That certainly felt like Dr. Boll's deep dark fantasies of what he really wanted to do to the general public for shitting on his movies for so long. But the acting was incredibly real, and the purposefully janky cinematography made the first half hour of the movie feel like a homemade documentary about how this deranged lunatic built up to go on a murder spree, with the rest just being murder porn. It at least shows he knows how movies work, and that makes the rest of his filmography feel all the more jarring. How the hell did he fund these movies anyway? Oh, he's also known as the man who beats the shit out of his critics in the ring for trashing his movies, so I guess I have something to look forward to for my troubles. But it's still impossible to talk about this movie without talking about the source material. Far Cry. Developed by German studio Crytek, yes, that Crytek, is among the first few first-person shooters I've ever played, next to Star Wars Jedi Outcast and that weird Star Trek game that was somehow better than the fucking movie. Far Cry is one of my favorite games of all time. Everything just clicks. The visual style, the aesthetics, the weapons, the sound design, that fucking killer soundtrack, oh. Yeah, yeah, yeah! The voice acting is quite shit.
Doyle, my armor's turning green!
But I think that adds to the charm. Everything has this exotic mid-90s action movie feel to it, between the pacing, plot points, gunplay, hammy acting, and the pseudo-futuristic sci-fi aesthetic.
Hey, look! It's a P90! Pancord Jackhammer, or ICW LGBTQ Assault Rifle. They look like they comes from the future. Fuck it!
It all results in a unique, challenging, and memorable experience that has only been rivaled in Far Cry 2. Which has nothing to do with the first game. A trend that Ubisoft borderline religiously follow through to the point where the series is just another derivative cash cow.
You hear that? Libertard?
The plot is fairly simple. It follows Jack Carver, an ex-Special Forces goon turned boat captain operating out of Micronesia, who is commissioned by CIA operative Valerie Constantine, working undercover as a reporter, who has him ferry her to some shady archipelago in the Pacific, where they are then ganked on by a roided-up band of mercenaries working for Dr. Krieger, a German man who does what Germans do best. Fucking everything up for everyone else. Engineering an army of mutant monkeys and soldiers for the highest bidder. The main course of the story is more about Jack trying to make sense of whatever the fuck he's gotten himself into.
I'm not even getting paid for this crap.
And the breakdown in combat effectiveness between the mercenaries as Jack's destruction of their supplies and communications arrays on the islands is used as a diversion for the seemingly sentient mutants to escape and begin their uprising. Simple. But effective. Far Cry Instincts largely follows the same plot from the original game, and is essentially the same game outside a more linear level design.
Wake up. Wake up.
Where am I? Where's Reznov?
Downgraded visuals so that the console peasants can at least play it, and this time, Jack has superpowers. But I'm not about to make this a review of the game, as tempted as I am, but I feel it's important to properly understand why Far Cry as a game works, at least on a surface level, for now, before we go on to why Far Cry the movie doesn't. So let's get the background details out the way. Far Cry was filmed through 2007 and released in October of 2008 to an ecstatic German audience. From what I can conjecture, the movie was shot in Canada. Wait, what? But Far Cry takes place in the jungle. Why the hell does it take place in Canada? Even the fucking plot summary seems just about as confused. You can even see near the exact same locale in the House of the Dead movie. I assume it's just cheaper to ferry the crew and actors and shoot the scenes in Canada rather than, say, Micronesia. But wait, this movie had a budget of $30 million. Funded by tax evasion. So where did all that cash go? My best guess is that it went into the actors. Let's see, we have Till Schweiger as Jack Carver. I've seen him in Inglourious Bastards. He was pretty cool.
Say auf Wiedersehen to your Nazi boss.
And he definitely looks the part. Emmanuel Vivogier as Valerie. She was in CSI and 2.5 Men. There's this guy from Stargate.
That's not what we commissioned from you, Doctor.
There's Ralph Muller. I think I remember him from Gladiator, and goddamn, he's built like an absolute Chad. Udo Kier as Dr. Krieger, and I gotta say, I don't think anyone could have been cast more perfectly than this guy. He's seriously the real-life personification of the character. I mean, fucking look at him. If only he was given better material, but we'll get to that. He has quite the extensive resume, though I don't think I've seen any of the stuff he's been in. Though he apparently voiced Dr. Straub in COD World War II Zombies. You know, the only part of that game that was any good whatsoever. Then there's... holy shit, is that Craig Fairbrass?
Nice! Your fruit-killing skills are remarkable.
So you can probably tell that the cast consists of a bunch of pretty cool dudes. Although you'll soon learn the fact that Dr. Boll somehow convinced them to be part of this movie is more impressive than all of their performances put together. But enough beating around the bush. I've stalled for long enough. Let's get into the movie, shall we? I'll run this review as a play-by-play of the movie itself and compare it to the game primarily through its narrative and presentation where necessary. And I pinky promise I will refrain from making a single generic definition of insanity joke throughout the course of this review, because I'm not a hack. The movie starts with a cold open action sequence. It sports a gang of nameless goons clad in black shitting bricks over a wrecked vehicle in front of them, before the featherweight tension is cut by one of these nerds spouting a line just asking for them to die first.
Is that it? Is that all you got?
Nope.
What the hell even happened to this guy? He gets his booty grabbed into the vehicle, but then we see him being force-pulled all over the outside windshield like he's a fucking Gmod ragdoll. I do like this guy's MP5 with a grenade launcher, but I was under the impression that this was a Far Cry movie, not Half-Life. Then the movie turns into Predator, leaving this guy to plead to his commander for support to no avail. Why is a dollar store Jaws theme playing in this scene? It's not before long that the last man standing gets assaulted by the cameraman.
And that was the last one, Dr. Krieger.
Outstanding. Absolutely outstanding.
So outside of being the tamest, most stock opening action scene ever, we come to the first most egregious insult to the game. There is now no room for doubt about the whole mutant plotline. The movie spoils one of the game's first twists in a matter of fucking seconds. Now there's no avoiding this, but Far Cry the game did tease the presence of mutants right off the bat as well in its intro cinematic. But that intro cinematic is trippy as far. It's fast-paced, it's tense, it's confusing, and you're left questioning what the fuck you just witnessed and whether or not what you saw was even real. Hell, you don't even see a single mutant until like 2 hours into the game, and they're only vaguely teased or hinted at through the idle mercenary dialogue.
Me, I ain't eating no damn shark.
What's wrong with shark?
Don't you know what the sharks around here have been eating? Where do you think all of Krieger's failed experiments go?
Dude, that's just wrong.
But one thing is certain. There are people shooting at you, they blew up your boat, and they're coming for you. And it's gonna be one hell of a trip before you're getting out of here. Here, it's pretty plain there's spooky shit afoot, communicated through the most clunky and generic action set piece I think I've ever seen. But this intro brings me to another important point. Dr. Boll is wasting time. The original game sets off immediately as Jack is having his boat blown up by the mercenaries, and it takes half a fucking hour of a 1.5 hour long movie to even get to that point. Why not just drop the theatrics and cut out the middlemen and start the movie off like the game did? The game expresses everything you need to know about the basic premise in the first minute, and the mystery surrounding the mercenaries' presence and Krieger's experiments is one of the story's strong points, bolstered by the fact that it is told entirely through Jack's perspective. You witness, experience, and react to these events just as he does. And while he's not a silent protagonist by any means, he has just enough character to lend him an actual personality, while also allowing the player to imprint their own experiences onto him. But this is gonna lead on to another issue I have with this movie, and I'm afraid I'm gonna have to save that shit for later.
Where are the whales, Jack?
Really? This is how we're kicking off the movie? Really?
You promised me whales, George.
Oh, God.
Well, that's funny, because we scheduled them to breach over our boat exactly at 2:45 and...
Oh, right. Jack Carver's German now.
Well, let me tell you something about American customer service.
I don't need to tell you that Jack wasn't German in the game, so this decision really strikes me as odd. And I'm really starting to question Schweiger's casting now. Granted, he looks the part, but that's about it. He acts and sounds nothing like him. Of course, it's better to have him do his natural accent than do an abhorrently butchered American accent, but he's still miscast in any case. I can't believe I have to go back on one of my few initial praises of the movie so fucking quickly. So this is Jack's first scene. What do you learn about his character in these first 5 minutes of screen time? Well, he's German, he wears a Hawaiian shirt in the Pacific Northwest, and he's a real stickler for timekeeping, I guess. First impressions are everything, guys. A main character's first scene in the movie is usually their most important. It's like when authors say the first 8 lines in a book is often the most crucial. A character's first scenes are the viewer's medium of figuring out his or her personality and how they operate. Far Cry has done the exact opposite, establishing that Jack has zero personality whatsoever, a trend that spills over to most of the other characters as well. And Schweiger clearly doesn't give a shit about anything he's doing.
Hey, and, watch out for those rocks here. They're pretty sharp and big.
Hey, man, I understand. Actors gotta pay the bills like the rest of us. It's just a shame it had to be like this. And is it just me, or does this scene feel really jarring? Like we're just past the threshold holding two entirely separate movies apart. Is this an artistic decision, Dr. Boll? Real quick, let's mosey on over to Far Cry Instincts and see how they introduced Jack in that game. Well, right off the bat, it's pretty plain that Jack is a bit of a sleazebag who's more interested in keeping his property and assets intact.
What, didn't the Navy teach you how to navigate through shallow water?
No, it just taught me never to trust a court-appointed lawyer, and to always protect my investments.
He's also a total wise-ass.
Me, I'd force you to drink nerve gas, but my employer's got a soft spot for dumb animals.
Explains hiring practices.
Holy shit, you fucking killed her, dude!
So I don't understand how this could have already gone so wrong. You had the formula right there, and you still fucking blew it. Granted, any attempt to recreate such a straightforward but implicitly informative scene would have resulted in just a cheap knockoff, but that's still sure to be 1,000 times better than having a scene with no personality and nothing going on. Outside a cringe, that is.
But George, what about the whales?
Oh, God, make it stop! We cut to Dr. Krieger evilly listening to Wagner and evilly getting drunk while painting.
Chernov?
Chernov! I'm not hearing gunshots!
And in comes the man himself to spit roast the good doctor for wasting the first 5 minutes of the movie on a pointless action sequence.
This is way beyond anything the command would authorize.
Oh no! His accent is so fucking bad! Why? Why would you make Craig pretend to be an American but not Schweiger? It hurts. It physically hurts to hear him speak.
Yeah, well maybe he'll send you out there next time.
Wait, did he just go fucking Scottish?
It's shy being Scottish!
Yeah! There's fucking Chibramana! And I'll shove your fucking head, your fucking arm!
And it's made all the more worse that he's actually trying. He's really fucking trying with what he's been given, but to no avail.
All of those genetically modified soldiers, or whatever you want to call those creatures, are all once human.
This is so fucking depressing. My best guess is that his character is supposed to be Crow, the leader of the mercenaries.
Parker.
Oh, sorry, his name is Parker. Right, okay, well,
Don't you think it's a little far-fetched?
And again, we cut away to another scene, this time with Valerie. If you haven't noticed, Dr. Boll has a checklist of characters he needs dedicated scenes to introduce them in. And if there's anything I can say about this movie already, it is painfully formulaic. And let's get this out of the way. Valerie is no longer a CIA operative undercover as a reporter. She's just a reporter.
Boring!
All the character she's left with is the obscene amount of makeup she has on. Valerie in the game was shady as fuck, bordering on femme fatale territory at times, and took pleasure in bossing Jack around without coming across as an unlikable bitch.
There's no time, so we need to split up, and you need to stop bitching. Got it?
I love the kind of woman that will actually just kill me.
Movie Valerie. I think I might just call her Moo Valerie from now on. Moo Valerie is the safest female lead ever, and she ends up doing nothing but making Jack get off his ass because it's required by the plot, and getting captured later on in the film. Game Valerie got captured twice, but she weren't no pushover. Far from it. Fighting alongside Jack against the mercenaries and mutants on more than one occasion. So it's painful to see the character stripped of her autonomy and replaced by this plastic blob.
Why are you so determined to follow this lead?
Because it's too good of a story to pass up. Besides, I've got a personal interest.
Okay, that's hilariously convenient. Just because this guy both A, knows Jack, and B, has Valerie as his niece, is the entire reason this plot is even happening. That is laughable. And we're really going for the stock, oh, I gotta save my family, motivation. Is she Vin Diesel? I'm not even joking. If it wasn't for this set of highly specific coincidences, Krieger might have been able to continue his eugenics hobby to his heart's content until the end of time. So I guess Ralph Müller is Doyle, the equally as sketchy CIA inside man within Krieger's facility.
But you have a choice, Max.
Oh, sorry, his name is Max. Okay. Oh, also, Valerie's surname in this movie is Cardinal instead of Constantine. This is probably a mind-bogglingly subtle reference to the fact that her surname changes to another hard-C name in every adaptation she's in. Truly, Dr. Boll's genius knows no bounds. We head back over to the super-secret science research center, and General Boss Nass over here is giving Krieger the Norman Osborn treatment.
No more funding until you produce something that we can use.
I'm gonna pull your funding.
I missed the part where that's my problem.
Still got the moves.
Only Krieger doesn't have any of the sympathetic qualities that Osborn had. And at least Osborn actually took his own fucking serum. Krieger, of course, being the Sigma male that he is, takes his own serum after booting Jack out of a helicopter into a mutant-infested hellhole and handing him over a rifle for shits and giggles. But of course, and I'm not afraid to spoil it, Krieger never takes his own serum in this movie. It would probably be very difficult, if not impossible, given Udo Kier's age, and nobody clearly gave enough of a shit about this movie to consider prosthetics or CGI at the very least. But no, I don't want to think about how that CGI would have turned out.
Oh God, you gotta help me! Jesus Christ!
Here's one we took the liberty of field testing ourselves.
Oh my God, this is a mutant? Are you fucking kidding me? He's white!
Shoot him.
Shoot him?
Yes, shoot him.
Shoot him?
Shoot him.
Shoot him?
Yes.
Oh! Oh my God!
He's white and bulletproof?
Subcutaneous armor?
Pretty crazy, huh?
Is Krieger succumbing to his base German instincts? Is he trying to create the pure Hyperborean master race?
You're making brainless monsters!
Oh boy, here we go.
Sedate him!
Doing?
Far Cry mutant design. There's chimps, gorillas, jumping jacks, these sneaky fuckers you can only see with night vision, and these thick motherfuckers who quake the ground where they tread and have a fucking rocket launcher strapped to their arms. Seriously, these things were terrifying when I was a kid. This was the best that Dr. Boll could come up with?
Oh shit, no. Fuck off, man. People keep asking me why I hate air vents.
What good is that, a weapon that we can't control?
You can use him under certain circumstances for the military.
That's not what we commissioned from you, Doctor.
What are you talking about? I'm sure the CIA in particular would love a brainless genocidal maniac that is completely bulletproof. Fuck, the bulletproof skin is an insanely advanced scientific breakthrough on its own. Sure, he just tried to kill you, but seriously? Krieger's got some shit going on here, and I can't be the only one who sees the benefit in a borderline indestructible character. chaos magnet being dropped in behind enemy lines. Imagine something like that in North Korea. Sure, civilian casualties would be a sure thing, but since when has the CIA cared about that? And besides, sedatives clearly work on him. Why not just hit the fucker with nerve gas when the time had come to recontain him? Haven't you played SCP? And wait, what the fuck is the US government doing taking Krieger's calls? Krieger in the game, being the fucking absolute giga-chad that he is, got caught doing human experimentation in the US government, and his natural reaction was to just found his own company and keep doing it anyway. What a fucking chad. I mean, the CIA being pissed that Krieger's doing his same old shenanigans, but now potentially willing to sell it to the enemies of the state, is exactly why they went in the first place. We didn't need some dumb familial connection to get the plot rolling. Valerie went in on good intel from her inside man Doyle, and Jack was just the insurance policy. The only reason he was even there was because the CIA checked him out, not because the plot said so, so this is how we're doing it. It was always going to be him. Sure, his entire rampage on the island was born from being in the wrong place at the wrong time, but not built upon as many coincidences in this fucking movie.
Why am I doing this to myself?
But I suppose I'm dragging this out a bit. Let's skip ahead in the movie, shall we? So Jack and Moo Valerie finally set off for the island after these two boomers come dangerously close to capping each other.
Get him up!
Yes, pet.
They exchange exposition like,
"Hey, I know Max."
"No, you don't. Who?"
"You know, Tish Tennis."
"What?"
"That was your safe word, Tish Tennis."
Safe word? They finally get to the island in the middle of the night, and out of nowhere, they seem to be channeling the "I'm teetering on the verge of murdering you" energy from the two boomers from 5 minutes ago.
"You better be here when I get back."
"You better be here when I get back."
Then Moo Valerie gets captured. Oh no, what a twist! And this guy comes out of nowhere with a fucking rocket launcher to kickstart the plot of the movie. About fucking time. Wait, why is the rocket arcing downwards? Didn't he fire his RPG directly at the boat? Let's get a narcissist depiction up for just a second. So RPG Merc is over here, and Jack is over here. RPG Merc fires his rocket launcher, and it launches forward for a few seconds before jutting upwards suddenly, and then it kind of just... But now we're a third of the way through the movie and we've only just caught up to where the game fucking starts. So I guess that means none of the cool shit that happens in the games is gonna make it into the movie. No bunker, no archives, no ancient ruins, no sneaking through the jungle, no... Oh, this isn't even a Far Cry movie, is it? But we finally get our first real action sequence. Yeah, go on, Jack, fucking pew 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 pew. Whoa, whoa, whoa! What's with all the fucking cuts, Dr. Boll? Are you trying to outcut Taken 3? It's a good thing nothing about this action sequence was visible, otherwise we might have been able to see just how poorly acted and choreographed it was. Wait, hold up! Where the fuck is his Hawaiian shirt? He fucking ditches it! For God's sake, that Hawaiian shirt was the one thing connecting this movie to the game, and you fucking threw it in the trash, you sacrilegious bastard! Okay, I understand why he ditches it. It's not like no one's gonna not see him when he's walloping about in a bright red Hawaiian shirt in the forest in the middle of the fucking night. But Jack in the game got by just fine with it. I'm pretty sure that Hawaiian shirt is the sole reason there's schmucks on the internet wondering why enemies can spot them from over 100 meters away when they're also standing out in the fucking open.
I don't think they can see me from way over there. That's just pushing it. And they saw me. Okay.
Seriously, just because the game's AI is a lot less brain dead than what you're used to doesn't mean the game is bad. Get fucking good. And now for another opportunity to gush all over this wonderful game. If you've played Far Cry on the hardest difficulty and don't suck, then you'll know that the best way to get through encounters is by avoiding them entirely, or otherwise ending them as fast as possible. Which makes the next scene where Jack basically charges a Humvee headfirst, guns blazing with nothing but a pistol, all the more hilarious. You know what would happen if you did that in the game? No, Far Cry is a thinking man's first-person shooter that takes advantage of its level's wide scope and varied terrain. There are multiple paths for you to take in pretty much 90% of the entire game, and even when the level design gets way more linear, you're still given multiple routes to progress through and different methods of handling any given situation. And I think that's the fatal flaw with trying to adapt, unquote, a video game into a movie. You're sacrificing the innate interactivity and potential branching paths of the source material for an inherently devolved, intensely more linear experience. It doesn't help that the people behind these adaptations tend to completely miss the point of what made these games, their stories, and their settings so memorable in the first place. I'm looking at you, Paramount. But I'm getting off topic again, and I'm only making more work for myself. So yeah. At least Jack throws rocks, like in the game. Yeah. Those bullets would tear straight through that car door.
Shall we have a look to see how much of it has gone through?
Oh. It's gone straight through.
And it had kept going.
Oh, Lord!
Oh, my God. How's that happened?
That machine gun would tear straight through that car.
Oh man, here we go, car chase scene. This is so fucking cool. I sure wonder who's gonna win in this scenario.
Surely not the main characters.
Come. Stop them!
Alright, who the fuck is this woman? And why is she within 50 miles of a movie set? She can't act to save her sodding life. And every line of hers is horribly dubbed over, poorly pronounced, and just fucking listen!
The best money can buy. Not much of a killer instinct for a soldier. Start the search. I want confirmation they're dead.
I'm not a robot. I'm a unicorn.
What the fuck? But of course, they escape, who would have guessed it, and they find shelter in some kind of shack on the coast. What the fuck is he doing? Is he 6 years old or what? This is the moment Til Schweiger figures out he's gay as fuck, isn't it?
Is that your gun?
Well, I never got to bed without it.
Never mind, they have sex. Or at least implied sex, anyway.
You didn't answer my question.
What do you mean?
On a scale from 1 to 10, how would you rate me?
2.
2?
You're coming back to base camp.
Undress. I wasn't talking to you, I was talking to her.
Unironically, this mercenary has more personality than anyone else in the movie combined. But as a side note, this guy right here looks like he has severe Down syndrome. I guess they don't call them special forces for no reason. First, I want to talk about the mercenaries themselves. What the hell is with their uniform? That's not a ballistic vest or tactical gear at all. That's a fucking cheap hunting vest. I know because I literally own the exact same type of vest that they're wearing in the movie. I'm gonna retract what I said earlier about this guy having more personality than any of the named characters, because guess what? These guys are just nameless goons with no lines and nothing separating them from every other generic throwaway cannon fodder you're seeing in all these other movies. They literally exist to get their assholes diddled and nothing else. Now, while that naturally was the purpose of the mercenaries in Far Cry the game, they were very animated and very talkative.
Well, keep your eyes open. We'll take care of him if he tries to come in here.
Yeah, take care of him real good.
Go take your break. Good. I'm hungry. You're off duty now. Good. I'm hungry.
Naturally, there's none of that in the Far Cry movie, because, well, not only does it not have the room for it, but it doesn't have any of the soul or imagination that went into the first game anyway. And for some reason, the mercenaries are split off into two different factions, the Greens and the Blacks. That sounds weird saying that. The thing is, they all use the exact same gear, and the only thing indicative of any differences between them is the color of their uniform. Are they two separate PMCs? Are they literally the same faction, but one is more elite than the other? I mean, the mercenaries in the game had an elite division with better body armor, weapons, and helmets, but they were all under the command of the same guy with a centralized command structure. And of course, we have to have a generic, oh no, she kills her own men, that's how you know she's a bad guy scene.
Any more complaints?
Yeah, is friendly fire covered under my life insurance? Because, why the fuck not? It's literally the laziest plot device ever. So Val gets captured. Again.
Leave her alone!
While Jack's wandering around the base dressed like a merc. I guess this is fucking Hitman now. And then he meets... Food Guy.
Ow! Oh, my back! Oh, my back! Oh, I think I compressed the disc!
He hijacked the boat, then he hijacked me! I don't like him, I don't even know him! Yeah! Yeah! Come on, I'll be your personal valet! I can help you in many ways! I'm the Food Guy!
no joke, he is the cringiest character in any movie I've ever seen. Every line that comes out of his mouth is an assault on my fucking soul.
I wanted to die fast, you know, like by a shark.
Try to remember some of the basics of CQC.
And here we have a boat chase, not even 10 minutes after the last chase sequence. I'm unable to express just how boring this sequence is. It's literally just a bunch of people waving their guns around, all looking like they want to go home. What the fuck? Oh, my sight! Every time I watch this fucking scene, I can't help but burst out laughing. He falls backwards and then vaults himself down the fucking side. You can see him flailing around on the floor in this shot. But in the next scene, Schweiger is in a completely different position and he's dangling over the fucking side! Anyway, fast forward from the generic boat chase scene, they get captured. Krieger confronts them with more generic exposition.
I'm going to hit you with my new experiment. Okay, see you later.
And then he switches Wagner back on to give Moo Valerie the Sigma male treatment.
I want to see him, or I'm not saying another word.
You will see him, and you will say another word.
Max is right. You're a sick, egotistical maniac.
Let's not go over the top. I'm just greedy.
He reunites Moo Valerie with Jack, not realizing the inevitable security breach that this scene is literally setting up hook, line, and sinker.
We gotta escape, and stop your choking, you big baby!
In case you didn't notice, Moo Valerie hands back the handcuff keys that Jack gave her to get out of the handcuffs back in the car chase scene.
It's an original handcuff key.
Where'd you get that?
Never leave home without
colonoscopy.
As far as reincorporation goes, it's not bad. There was no indication that it was anything more than a one-off Deus Ex Machina for that one scene, but I at least appreciate some modicum of effort in the writing. If you can even call it that. This scene literally just sounds like gay sex.
There it goes. No, I missed it. You do it. You do it. Ow, ow.
Upright dance camp. Upright dance camp.
But oh no, shock and horror, Krieger sets a mutated Max on them. Jack somehow survives by repeating the safe word for presumably their combined body heat sessions in the German army.
Maybe violence isn't the answer.
Again, I appreciate the somewhat effective use of reincorporation, but it's not gonna help this movie any. Just because you did it twice in 2 minutes doesn't mean I'm gonna score your movie any better, Dr. Ball. This next scene is fucking great, though. Jack turns into fucking Mario.
Wah-wah-ha! Whoa! Yahoo!
They teach you that in the German army. Max goes Mr. X and all the other white boys in the facility. One of them smashes through a window, grabs a machine gun, starts shooting out all the windows, and that somehow activates the fire alarm and releases all the mutants from their cells. How the fuck do any of these events even come together in the slightest? But fuck it, we finally get our mutant outbreak in like the last 10 minutes of the movie, and whatever scenes aren't of the mercenaries getting their shit kicked in is of Jack, once again, running away from the... Does he do anything in this movie other than running away? Deja vu, I've just been in this place before, higher on the street. Man, this new Dying Light game's looking pretty good. But he finally fends off his pursuers and comes face to face with... Hey! Why does it sound like there's a rave going on in the background? Craig Fairbross wants to get out of this movie faster than I do, so he teams up with Jack to secure Krieger's boat and escape.
Follow it. Stairs down to the ground floor.
Thanks.
Wait a second.
Remember, switching to your pistol is always faster than reloading.
Thank you.
But unfortunately...
Where are they going?
They're withdrawing on my orders.
that was fucking disappointing. Cut to a sequence of the black troopers doming all of the green troopers. This guy wasn't even aiming at that guy. And they're all waddling around like they're fucking drunk. Man, I need a fucking drink. Oh no, we got a standoff here. Jack has Krieger, Chernoff has Moo Valerie. This wouldn't have happened if Jack just used Krieger as a human shield, shot Chernoff in the back, and dispatched the other two guys next to her. But it doesn't even matter anyway, because he fucking lets him go without even demanding an exchange. And believe it or not...
Kill him.
Wait, what the fuck are those guys in the background doing? Wait, where did they come from? Wait, where did you come from?
X gon' give it to you. What? Fuck, wait for you to get it on your own. X gon' deliver to you. Knock, knock, open up the door, it's real. With the non-stop pop up.
What are you waiting for? Chinese New Year? Go, go, go!
Of course, Chernoff and Max get the most anticlimactic death scenes in history. Because nothing could be more fitting for their characters than that.
Max!
Is that all you have to say? You just watched your uncle get turned into a mutant monster and shot in the fucking face, and all you have to say is... I fucking hate you so much. So they escape by nicking Krieger's boat, leaving Krieger to just stare off into the distance while looking mildly annoyed, I guess.
Step back!
Those are your last words? And, well, that's pretty much it. From this point, all's well that ends well. Jack gets a new boat, is still shagging Moo Valerie. Food Guy is still working with Jack for some reason. I especially like how Moo Valerie is showing no trauma or, you know, any emotion at all towards her uncle fucking being murdered earlier. And...
Hey, Jack!
I think you owe us some whales, Jack! Little lady wants to see some whales.
They wanna see whales.
Nope.
He's German, he's emotional.
Fuck yourself.
Oh, jeez!
Oh, about fucking time. This video took way too long to make, and I've been spending way too much time watching this abhorrent fucking movie. I wish there was more to say about it, but there really isn't. Barely anything happens, Till Schweiger's an absolute personality vacuum, the dialogue is the most generic I've ever heard in my entire life, they butchered the setting, they sharted over the story, none of the events that actually take place have any weight to them, and it's so personally insulting to me because my love for the game knows no bounds. If the second half of this review seems a little rushed, that's because I legitimately ran out of things to say about the movie. Past the comparisons to the game, this movie has literally nothing holding it together. It feels like staring at a blank wall for an hour and a half. It's just that dull. This is, honest to God, the worst movie I've ever seen in my life. It's not even so bad that it's good. It's bad because it's utterly boring. But you know what's not boring? Far Cry the game, which you can pick up on Steam for about £9. If you've seen any other big YouTuber play this game and worry about the game being buggy or the widescreen interface being horrendously outstretched, not to worry. The Far Out widescreen patch on ModDB is here to help. It fixes the outstretched HUD, improves the field of view and view model positioning, and fixes a bunch of in-game bugs such as enemy shooting through walls. It is truly one of my favorite games of all time. Even after 16 years of me playing it, I'm still finding new secrets and hidden locations scattered all across the intricately designed and beautifully crafted levels. The gameplay is second to none, and I wish I could chill for it for longer, but I really gotta finish this fucking video. But if you're interested in more Far Cry content from me, I will be streaming the original game on the hardest difficulty, realistic mode, over the next few days, starting from tomorrow evening. It'll be on this channel, so it's easy enough to find. And I'd really appreciate your attendance. It'll be a lot of fun. And of course, I have a Patreon link in the description. If you want to help build this channel with me into something great, I'd implore you to at least check it out. But that's enough e-begging for one day. Thank you for watching, and please, don't make me do another video game movie ever again. Especially if it's made by Dr. Boll. I think I might go insane if I do that shit again. No!